welcome to the 1996 Pan American Rugby Series. We're coming to you from Ottawa. This is game two. It's Uruguay against Canada. Along with Tommy Smith, I'm Mike Hill. Rugby union, Tommy, and really four emerging nations, and Uruguay, a nation really on the way up at the moment.
Yeah, we're having a look at them. You can see many of them around the 20-year mark, some of them on the young age. Costabile there, and it's probably the oldest man on the team, Luango. He's probably the most experienced man at 31, and Cosquera is very close to him, 30 years of age. You can see big men, Mike. That's what makes these players so good.
Well, Machia, the big captain, the number eight of the team, he locks the scrum for them. You can see there are a lot of them with their caps in the teens, although the lock there at 36 years old with 37 caps. And then the two props up front and some inexperience there. And the hooker, just one appearance, and that's Suarez. He's a big, strong 21-year-old, and he leads the pack.
Well, he loves to play, and Herrera has done a good job of putting them together. He's been with them since 92, and he's had a couple of very, very good results. I mean, that time when they beat Spain, 47-10. Anytime you can take Spain out, you're doing well in international rugby.
So that's the Uruguay lineup. As we see the skyline of Ottawa, and the host country starting their campaign for this an American championship. Canada, one of the up-and-coming countries, and this is their lineup: Joseph Haley, the 21-year-old fullback, and they've got pace on the wings, Tommy.
Yeah, they certainly have. A little inexperience here. Nichols, this is his first cap. Brian is his first cap, but in comparison, Stewart is 30 caps. And you can see Rob Card only two caps as well. So they're trying to combine the veterans, and the number eight player there, well, he's never been capped before and either. That could be pivotal, Mike.
Yes, there is some experience, but as you can see there, there is basically a very new side, and it's a side that's actually being prepared looking ahead to the 1999 World Rugby Cup. The hooker is Scott Hendry, and he's another novice. And they're coached by Pat Parfry, and he really is looking towards the future. The crowd is building up as we get ready for the kickoff. It's the second game. It's Canada against Uruguay, and we'll be bringing you all the action when we return. Canada against Uruguay, game two of the Pan American Rugby Series. Kickoff is next. Welcome back then to Ottawa, Uruguay against Canada. That's our second match of this 1996 Pan American Rugby Series. Waiting for the team to arrive, and first out, the team from Uruguay. Both these sides looking towards the future. And Uruguay building up quite a tradition in rugby. Of course, South American rugby for so long has been dominated by Argentina. Uruguay certainly making inroads and playing more and more international matches now, and certainly their club rugby around Montevideo is becoming very strong indeed.
Well, these are an unknown force here today, but certainly, Mike, when you look out of the field, they're all big men. I mean, I'm looking at Suarez out there, huge number two, and the number eight, well, they don't have a whole lot of experience between them. Dabo should be a force here, the number seven, Sciara, the number nine player, and of course Aguirre, the fullback. Well, a lot will depend on his kicking today.
And there is just the confirmation of the reserves. Each team names six possible replacements as Uruguay go through their warm-up. Just making sure they get a good feel of that ball. The grass quite long here in Ottawa. The pitch itself is quite firm.
So many of them from Carrasco Polo Club in Uruguay, and the man in the middle who's conducting everything out there, Sciara, is one of those players. So much will depend on his distribution today. That's if they can get him the ball. Canada, of course, coming into this would have to come in and be rated as the favourites in this tournament, especially considering it's been played on their own turf.
Well, the Canadian side now making its way out and getting a tremendous welcome from the home supporters. As you can see, they're a very young side, as they eye 1999, the next World Cup. This is the Pan American Rugby Series here on ESPN as we give you a final check on the Canadian side. That will be the forward pack, and they will be locked together there by the number eight. That's Mick Smith, and there are the backs. There's some pace there, and six reserves that they have named.
Oh, I'm just looking at Courtney Smith, the number 14 player there, Mike. Very unusual. Born in 1971. I mean, he's been around a long time. He has only four caps. I guess he's a late bloomer, is he? Something like myself.
Well, an enthusiastic crowd. The referee in charge of this match is Mr. Borsani, who comes from Argentina. Thiago Borsani for the watch, and everything now in readiness. It will be Canada in their red shirts who get this game underway, and they will be attacking the try line to the left hand end of the field. Breeze to speak of.
Well, the conditions look ideal here. The field is really lush and green, not soft.
Canada going for the short kickoff and trying to retrieve the ball just over that 10-yard line, and they've managed to do that. Canadian forwards there very, very quickly indeed.
Charo, the captain, was the first man in. A nice break by Hendry. I mean, this is an enthusiastic start by the Canadians, isn't it?
Yes, Scott Hendry, the hooker there. But Canada perhaps a bit too enthusiastic. There's the first big hit. And I'm sure we're going to see a lot more of those.
Oh, Hendry has come up through the ranks. He's played in the under-18, the under-21 team. And now he's on to the full international team.
Another penalty quickly taken by Uruguay. Fell into fine touch. Fullback there is Joe Haley. His kick there just rolling across, kept in play. And the Canadians starting off this game very fired up.
Nichols is the man who comes over and retrieves it, keeps it in play.
Some dangerous play that time, as a couple of the Canadians went over the ball, but the referee has allowed play to continue. And no respite at the moment.
Technically, it may not be the best game of the world, but they're really going at it hammer and tongs, aren't they?
Well, Haley there slicing his kick.
Well, to give the players a chance just to catch their breath and regroup after a start that really was very enthusiastic. Have to slow down.
Yes, Canada perhaps catching Uruguay out slightly with that very short kickoff, just getting it over the 10-yard line. And Canada were able to recover very quickly.
Well, the Canadians have a height advantage. That's an overall height advantage, but some of the players, well, a lot of them are on the 6-foot mark.
Ball knocked back. Taken there by the scrum half. That's Federico Sciara. Way forward at the moment. Now Sciara can play it wide. Lindro, the fly half, he's caught. Uruguay, though, getting the ball back, and now it's amongst the forwards. They can use their power. Canada coming over the top. I beg your pardon, he's out there at the moment. Hard running that time by Dabo, the big number seven.
Oh, he just keeps pulling his way forward.
And now, Anenza. Sciara again.
Sciara looks like a technically great player, Mike, doesn't he? He just has great distribution, great vision.
Oh, with plenty of pace out wide, if they can get it out to Courtney Smith and the other winger, which is Kyle Nichols. This is Scott Bryant, one of the centres. Another player with a lot of pace. That wasn't the best of passes, but Canada riding their fortune at the moment.
Oh, Healy hooking up well with Bryant.
Now, this time it's back amongst the forwards. This is Tony Healy. Trying to force his way through.
And forced it is. 6'6", 240 pounds. How would you like that coming at you?
Nichols on the far side, and referee has found a penalty. Argentina going over the offside line. Well, Canada already one win over Uruguay. As you see there in Montevideo, it was in 1995, they won 28-9.
Well, you can tell just from this Canadian outfit today, Mike, they're certainly looking towards the World Cup in 1999. That's their big things now.
Yeah, 16 nations will play in the World Cup finals, as they did in South Africa in 1995. Bob Ross, the fly half, sometimes referred to as the outside half or even the 5/8, is the player to take this attempted conversion.
The James Bate club, he made his debut back in 89 against Ireland. He's one of the players that's been around a while.
Some distance out, I would say about 35, even nearly 40 yards, and not the best of angles.
Well, if any man can make it, he can make it. He scored 105 points in the Pacific Rim tournament.
So Bob Ross gets the height, but not quite the direction. It's just wide. It's Uruguay 0, Canada 0. We'll be back after this. Welcome back. With about 12 minutes gone in this first half, still no score. Uruguay 0, Canada 0. It's been a frantic opening from both sides. And now that initial pace just going off of it. Both sides now just settling down to play their natural game. Canada would be the hot favourite. Uruguay, great jump there by Panenza.
What a fetch by Panenza. You could see him. He was head and shoulders over everybody. In fact, he was hips and legs over everybody. He got up so high.
Yes, he was being lifted. I think that's why the referee has penalised him. But he got tremendous high, didn't he?
I thought he had still stare or something for a while. I couldn't believe he could get up that high.
It's Canada with the put in. Rob Card, their scrum half. And the front rows there, just not binding quite right at this stage. It's always this soft-in period in the first perhaps 15 or 20 minutes of any game between the two front rows as they try to stamp their authority on the game. The Canadian pack is collapsed. Ball still came out the Canadian side, but referee will have the scrum retaken.
Star of the future there, getting ready for the action. You can see him limbering up already. He wanted to get in there right now, Mike.
This rugby union, one of the most played sports all around the world. Perhaps only association football. He's played in more countries than rugby union football, the 15-a-side game.
Oh, that's where that term soccer came from, because they're trying to associate it with association football rather than rugby back about 100 years ago in England. And that's how they differentiated.
Pass back, and Canada there in a bit of trouble. Wasn't the best of pass backs. They've got the ball clear, but they really haven't cleared their lines by too much at this stage.
Well, the pass back was pretty decent, but it was very, very deep, and Haley was the man who booted it out of there. He didn't get a whole lot of distance, got plenty of height in it. I suppose he was more sure than he wanted just to be safe, Mike.
This line out some 3 yards away from the touchline. And the goal line as well, as a push by Uruguay as they try to force this one over. Good turn from the scrum. Can they get it
they're
down?
There,
yes.
There.
Well, in the end, it was just the weight and, well, who got that one down?
Kalandra was the man who, I believe, pushed it over. And
yes, the big prop, Tommy.
Well, he is a big prop. I mean, he just kept pushing, Mike. I thought they might have been over initially before even they got the try. It looked like on the first initial movement. Watch when it comes back. You see them building up now. Kalandra's in there someplace. He's pushing. I thought he was over at that stage, but then he just squeezes over. The referee makes the good call right there. There's a try.
I think he might have got over, but he couldn't get the ball down. You see there, he was just being held up, and then eventually, just his strength, he's able to roll himself over and then just plant that ball down.
Well, he uses one of his teammates, Dababa's back, to roll him off, and he rolled it on in.
So Uruguay, 5-0 ahead, and an opportunity to add a couple more points.
Oh, this could be a big surprise in the making.
Height was right, the direction wasn't. It's fourth wide that time by Sciara.
Sciara probably knows he should have done better with that one.
Uruguay 5, Canada 0. The Pan Am Rugby Tournament coming to you from Ottawa here on ESPN. Canada again with that short restart. And this time Uruguay were ready for it, but the referee there just spotting a knock on. Be a scrum.
Oh, I'm surprised that Canada are trying that short kick all the time, Mike. You'd imagine playing against such a strong team like this, you'd be trying to get it as far down the field as it could and then hope.
Especially when you think the speed that Canada have got in their back line. They did play it long, the backs could get down there and really put on the pressure. Canada now have got a penalty. Uruguay going in over the ball.
Well, Rob Carr, the scrum half there, has done a good job of putting it in.
Players from Uruguay who's at the bottom of that ruck, and you can see one of the Canadians there, Tommy, really not quite sure where he is at the moment. There was a very heavy clash between both those players.
Well, the Uruguayan player is in a bit of agony too. It looks like they're working on his ribs, Mike. Maybe a hip pointer.
Yes, I think that's what the referee is indicating, that he's got a knock in the ribs. And that's why referees are so strict on players coming in over the scrum and coming in from the wrong side as well. And Daro is the player who is back on his feet. And that was the fly half. And the player going off there is Scott Stewart, the centre. He really is quite sure if he knows where he is at the moment.
Yeah, I think he just got his brain scrambled just a little bit with that last... it was a clash of heads. I think his head went down on the hip of the Uruguayan player, Mike, and that's what caused so much of a problem.
Well, Scott Stewart is going to come out, and Jason Penaluma is the player who comes on. So this kick for Bob Ross. It's fouled on his first two. Now an opportunity to bring the score closer together. He's taking his time. Just takes four steps. This time gets the height and gets the direction. Canada are on the scoreboard. And with some 18 minutes gone, it is now Uruguay 5, Canada 3. And we'll have more from the Pan American Rugby Series when we return. Welcome back then. Uruguay 5, Canada 3. And it will be Uruguay to restart after Bob Ross was able to convert that penalty for Canada.
Well, he's so good at them. In the Pacific Rim Tournament, he kicked 23 penalties, Mike. That's fairly good going.
Well, that's a bad kickoff. The ball hasn't gone the required 10 yards. Referee waiting to see if the advantage goes with Canada. And it looks as if it is going to, so he will allow play to carry on. Good surge forward that time. Here come Canada again, and very hard knock. And it came in from Peninza. And there was also a player offside coming in on the wrong side of the challenge.
Well, Canada's taken a long while to get into their stride, you know, and I mean, they are a fairly free-scoring team, Mike. They know how to score tries. A lot of injuries in this one, which has really stopped the flow of the play, hasn't it?
Yes, it's made it very difficult for Canada to really get into their rhythm. I think these stop-start tactics would be favouring Uruguay, Tommy, I would think.
Well, certainly when you have a team that's as big and strong and as heavy as Uruguay, what you want to do is you want to stop the game. And this is a similar accident to the injury that happened just a little while ago. It seems like the Canadians are getting their heads down low and they're coming in across on top of the hips. And that's the second time now a Uruguayan player has gone down on the hip pointer.
Well, the crowd are in good spirits here. One of the gentlemen there trying to start a Mexican wave in Ottawa.
He didn't have a whole lot of success, mind you.
He didn't, did he? It's just him on his own. Well, the number 10 there, Mendro, is back on his feet. He's been in the wars in this first half already. But another penalty now for Canada. Another opportunity for Bob Ross.
Oh, if you keep giving Bob Ross these kind of scoring opportunities, he certainly can punish you before the night is out.
Well, he's got one from three so far. So this an opportunity to actually put Canada into the lead. You can see how close to the halfway line he is.
I love his occupation. He lists his occupation as a player. He plays with the James Bay Club. Prolific scorer for Canada in the last 2 years.
Takes his time over these penalties. Will not be rushed. Now he's got the height. Not quite. It falls in the end. Just died at the last moment and went under the crossbar. The accuracy was, it was spot on, Tommy, right in the centre.
Oh, it certainly was, but it went down like a dead quail. You think somebody just shot it out of the air. It dropped down right under the bar at the last moment. Looked for a moment like it was going to go over the top, but just didn't make it.
Out there from the 22-metre line. Through that time is Courtney Smith, a speedy winger who likes to cut infield. Now they play it wide. Nichols was waiting on that far side. They've come back infield, linking up this time with the forwards. This is better from Canada now. This is what they want to do, move the ball quickly, move it wide. And Uruguay at the moment, a little bit disarray. There's been a real good surge from Canada, and it might not be all over yet. And Kevin Wierzchowski goes in. The front row forward who came in on the near side and was just able to bar his way over. Nobody was going to stop him, Tommy, when he was in full flight.
Well, he certainly got the right run. The man who made his debut way back in 92, and he made his debut at Wembley. Look at this. He's doing a little bit of celebration here. Watch the push off. The Canadians go down there, but he finds himself free on the outside. Good vision here, and he just dives for the line from that 2 yards out. He has support coming on the outside. Nichols is there. He doesn't need that support. He says, I'm going to go it on my own, and he just pushes his way on in.
So Kevin Wierzchowski bounding over that time. So that was good follow-up play from the forwards. But what a great move from Canada. That's more of what we've come to expect from them. So another opportunity now for Bob Ross. One from four. And this one would be the most difficult of all, I would think. Tommy's got a terrible angle. You can see how close he is there to the touchline.
Well, whatever chance he has, Mike, he has to just try to float it up on the top. I mean, this is a very acute angle. He's just got to float it up on the top and hope that it breaks down between the posts.
What would that be? Some 25 metres out.
But look at the angle.
This is going to be real accurate here. And no wind to speak of. Well, he hit it sweetly, but you can see there, just did not curl in at all, Tommy.
No, he got absolutely no curl to it. He hit it straight on, and it went in exactly the direction that he was facing. And you've got to get the curl on that one. You've got to float it over. Let's have a look at this try again, and you can see so many Canadian players involved in it. A nice push-off there by Hutchinson. Hutchinson pushing through, and then there's a nice retrieval of the ball here by Card. Card gets it across, and the big man pushes his way on in.
Yes, nobody was going to stop him from 5 yards out. So Canada now into the lead, 8-5.
Makes his living as an auto reader. He finishes off autos. I don't know which way he finishes them off. It doesn't explain that way. With that kind of strength, Mike, you never know what he might do to them. He must be the biggest man on the Canadian team.
It's very solidly built. And
once you get ahead of steam with a player like that, I mean, there was a couple of men on the line there, but I mean, there was no way they were going to stop in front of him.
Santiago Silva, who has come on for Uruguay. Now, he's also a fly half. So they've run a couple of changes. But Uruguay have been quite successful so far in the lineouts. They've won three. Great jump that time by Tony Healy for Canada. And another surge. It's rolling more that the Canadians have become real masters at. reaction of the crowd. The referee saying there that the Canadian was not releasing the ball, was holding it to him. Of course, once you go to ground, you have to release the ball.
Well, I think he was trying to take advantage of it and hold on to it, Mike, hoping that the maul would turn him over and he'd gain a couple more yards.
I think the way he went down, he was also facing the Uruguay line. He was hoping to be pushed over so that at least the ball would come out the Canadian side. But it's come out the Uruguayan side, but it's Canada who picked up the ball and now coming forward. Again, all across the width of this field, good passing movement. Number nine there, Rob Card. That's the player who's making it all tip for Canada at the moment. There's the try scorer, Rachowski, and now played wide. If they can get this right, they've got man advantage, and they've dropped it. The pass there from Courtney Smith. And you'd have to say, Tommy, that's got to be a try that they've bombed.
Oh, yeah, there's no question about it. Courtney Smith had it perfectly set up. Couple of Canadians with the opportunity. Nice play by Courtney Smith. It's picked up there by Card. He releases it out. Nichols is the man who switches it wide. Courtney Smith makes the break into the middle. And then just bad handling on the outside. Courtney Smith, a great dummy as he came down the middle and pitched it out on the right.
Uruguay haven't won a scrum as yet. Well, they've got the ball back in this one. That's their first scrum win. Picking the ball up is 15 there. That's Joe Haley.
Fullback hasn't had an awful lot to do in this one, Mike. We haven't seen any of his superb kicking, which we are told he's very capable of doing. Paluna was the man who mishandled the ball over on the far side when Courtney Smith cut back into the middle. I think he even faked out his own teammates, Mike. They thought he was going to drive for the post.
Yes, there just seem to be so many Canadians available at the end of that move that everybody wanted to get involved in the act, and sometimes if you've got too many options, it's very easy to get confused yourself.
Yeah, and there's too many cooks spoiled the broth, and certainly too many of the Canadians there missed out on the try.
So Diego Silva there organising things since he's come on for this Uruguay team. Tremendous jump again. Ace Lorenzo that time getting tremendous height. But he couldn't get it back clear. Cleanly enough.
The average age, surprisingly, there, the Uruguayans outrank the Canadians by a year, especially when you put Courtney Smith into the equation. But he has a lot of pace, hasn't he, out on that right-hand side. He certainly shows like he takes off like a sprinter.
Now Canada trying to push this Uruguayan pack around a little bit at the moment. Canadians just seem to bind so much better when they do go in. They're a much more forceful unit than the team from Uruguay. And now here goes Courtney Smith, showing us some of that pace. It's taken two to stop him. And he rolled over and left the ball for his Canadian teammates, but it was a Uruguayan player coming back who was clearly offside who handled that. And that's got to be a penalty for Canada. You can't do that.
Oh, I know sooner had the words out of my mouth about the pace he has, and look at him, he just takes off, loses his balance a little bit, and he's handled there. Aguirre is the man who handles him, and look at that, that's an offside call right there, Mike.
And that results in a penalty, so another opportunity now for Canada. And Bob Ross, it's an easier opportunity. He's only got one from five so far. But this one straight ahead, and as you can see there, the line in front of him is the 22-meter line, the 25-yard line. And this really, for a kicker of his ability, should really be a piece of cake. Right ahead. Takes his time. And plants that straight through the middle. So another 3 points for Canada. It now goes to 11-5. We're still in the first half. This is game two of the 1996 Pan American Rugby Series. Canada certainly one of the favourites, along with Argentina. of this four-team tournament.
Oh, Bobby Ross hit that one well, Mike, adding to his 121-point total coming into the game. But as you said, a piece of cake straight away.
It's Parfrey, the head coach of the Canadian side. And what great strides Canberra has made in recent years. Dave Doherty, his assistant. Indian teams now invited to international club tournaments around the world. Here goes Courtney Smith. And he's causing Uruguay a lot of problems. Nobody can keep up with him. And this should be a try. Penaluna takes it round to make the angle a bit easier. But although Penaluna was the player who scored the try, you've got to give that to Courtney Smith, Tommy, because his pace in midfield completely opened up this Uruguayan defence.
Oh, he sure did, and a little bit of good ball handling. This time, on the left-hand side, Penaluna looks much better. He had the ball on the right-hand side. Watch Courtney Smith. He breaks away there. Palour is the man who tries to take him out of it. He pushes off. Now he's looking for support. He said, here, I've had enough. You do the rest. And watch coming up on the far side. Penaluna is the man he has support. Look at that beautiful run. The Canadians stretch it all the way across the field. When they went on the right-hand side, they didn't. Penaluna says, let me go in the shadow of the post. And he puts it down.
A great team try that for Canada. But all made possible by the speed there from Courtney Smith, and his takeoff is, you would think he's sort of got rocket boosters in his shoes, Tommy. I mean, it's just, it's not only his speed when he gets running, but he's so quick off the mark. I mean, his acceleration is just unbelievable.
I have the feeling he was a sprinter when he was at school somewhere along the way, Mike, because he just has that sprint takeoff, even from a standing position. He doesn't have to be in blocks, this man.
So Bob Ross again, with an opportunity now to stretch the lead even further for Canada. And that one straight through again. He's found the range now. He's got his kicking boots on. And Canada now lead by 18-5. We're still in the first half.
Well, look at Courtney Smith. Look at it. He's looking around him all the time. He says, I'm going to break now. Now he realizes this is as far as I can go. Somebody else should come and pick up the slack. Nice ball played out there. Brian is involved in it. There's a couple of players involved in it. Nicol is the man who parts with it. And Penaluna is the man who says, let me break around the back here and put this beauty down.
And looking at that replay again, Tommy, I mean, it wasn't only the speed of Courtney Smith. It was also the way he kept his balance, because a couple of times he was nudged, a couple of times he was sort of ankle tapped and still managed to keep going.
And it was also very intelligent running, Mike, because he realized when he got turned, okay, I can't start again, so it's time for me to get rid of the ball. And as the Canadians were all coming, he had a lot of support. So good, intelligent play by Courtney Smith. You don't have to do it all on your own. As we've been pointing out, it is a team game, and that time the Canadians used the full width of the field.
Yes, and it was good support play there by the Canadians as well. Penaluna will have his name placed against the try. 39, 41. The signals are being shouted out at the moment. That's, I think, basically to confuse the opposition. Often, though, it seems to confuse the team that are shouting out the signals. Now, Canada taking that and a good, solid push from the scrum. Now the ball's back, and Bob Ross looking to find touch, which he manages to do.
Oh, Bob Ross kicking superbly now. I mean, from the dead ball situations as well as from his hands. But the key to that line-out was Felix, the big man, number 5, 6'6". He's only 2 test matches, but one was against Australia and the other against New Zealand. So he's highly rated, Mike. Those are two of the better teams in the world to be playing against.
Well, perhaps the top two teams in the world at the present stage, of course. The All Blacks winning the World Cup in South Africa in 1995, overcoming the Springboks in the final. And Australia always up there or thereabouts. The referee has found an infringement. Canada this time caught offside. Free from Argentina, Santiago Orsani hasn't missed too much.
Well, it's just a case that the class of the Canadians are starting to show just a little bit, Mike. They're a very free-flowing team, and
well, another change for Uruguay at the moment. Number 19 there coming on. So they're ringing the changes as they really are trying to stop this red tide, because Canada at the moment now sort of really dictating this game completely, Tommy. They're dictating not only the pace, but also where it's going to be played. They're spinning it wide, or they're playing it through the forwards.
Aguirre is going to try this one, Mike. This is a long one, just inside of the halfway line, and he'd be hitting it left footed, which should be okay, should be curling back into the post, but there's a lot of distance required here by the fullback from Uruguay.
The player that we saw has come on wearing the number 19, De Leon, is a lock or a flanker, as his penalty is taken by Diego Osuria. And he wouldn't be too happy with that kick, Tony, and nowhere near the uprights.
Well, you just had the sneaking suspicion that he wasn't going to have the length on it. I mean, that was a mighty long kick, and Bob Ross just kicked for touch there and found it so easily. Not too many Gary Owens in this game. We don't see much of that kicking up and under, trying to run under it here. It's more a kind of a dominance game by the Canadians, spreading it wide across the width of the field, hoping that they can use their pace to get by the Uruguayan team. It looked just a little bit slower.
Yes, I think that's it at the moment, Tommy. You hit the nail right on the head. The Canadians certainly look the more powerful of the two teams. Certainly they are the team with more pace. I think they're confident enough that if they get the ball in their hands, their pace will do enough. But they've been forced back here. This is a good shove by Uruguay. They're making up some ground. And in the end, it was the number one there, Calandro, who had to really go on his own, and then got stopped by half the scrum of Canada.
Well, I think as long as his feet were going forward, he was okay, Mike, but as soon as he got turned around and they were trying to hoist him on, that's when he got in trouble.
Well, that was perhaps the first time in this match, as we're coming up towards the half-time break, that we've really seen the power of this team from Uruguay. We were told that they're a team who can use power. We haven't seen it so far, but we did then, Tommy, and for the first time really in the whole game, Canada were on their back foot.
They certainly were, and they were being pushed back, and Uruguay going to try the penalty. They've changed the kicker. Mendro is the man who's going to try it this time, I believe, or is it Mendro is going to try it.
In fact, it's the player who's come on as a substitute,
Silva,
yes. Well, we haven't seen him kick before, Tommy.
Oh, this is good confidence in the player they just brought in. The confidence was mistaken, I think, was it?
Well, he got the distance. He didn't get the direction. And he didn't get the height. But he got one out of three, Tommy.
Maybe he should have let Mendro kick it instead of Silva. I think the crowd agree with me there.
So we're now into the stoppage time period at the end of this first half. Canada very much in control, but under pressure now. And if Uruguay could score a try going into this half-time break, we put a whole different complex on this game, as that one is lifted over and just dribbles into touch some 5 or 6 meters away from the corner flag.
We've got to feel that the Canadians got to get possession of this line out, because if the Uruguayans do and they get into a ruck there, they could push it over from here, Mike. I mean, this is very close to the Canadian line.
Well, Canada do have the put in.
So many numbers being called out. I'm not sure how you can keep track of them.
No, I don't think you're supposed to. It's just purely to confuse the opposition and commentators like us that are listening to it, Tommy. And they succeed, don't they?
They sure do. I'm expecting something spectacular here.
Scott Hendry with the throw. And Canada trying to get it away from the back line. And there, one of the forwards getting in the way of Rod Card. And the referee will have another scrum. And again, this is important that Canada do not lose or not pushed over here. And Uruguay with a put in, and this is an opportunity for them. They come wide. Stop that time was Ferraz. And Canada, thanks to Rob Card, get the ball high up and under. It hasn't gone out of play, and now it is dropped. It goes out of play, and the half-time whistle goes. Good finish of the first half for Uruguay, but on the scoreboard, it is Canada 18, Uruguay 5. And for Canada, after a slow start, they really did explode. Well, stay with us here on ESPN when we return. Welcome back then to the 1996 Pan American Rugby Series. Half time in the game between Uruguay and Canada being played here in Ottawa. And Canada in their half time huddle. Well, they should be very happy. They are leading 18 points to 5. And after trailing initially 5-0 to Uruguay, but they really came into it. And we looked, Tommy, at the half time statistics. And it really doesn't tell you how dominant Canada did become in that first half as it wore on.
No, as you look at those statistics, you'd be inclined to think that this is a very even game, and it's really not, because Canada has dominated. And as long as they keep the game wide, Mike, and don't allow the Uruguayans to bunch it up in the middle, Canada should be in good shape, because they've certainly got a lot of pace, and I think they can outfoot these Uruguayans to the try anytime. They just work it the right way.
It's so important they do work it the right way, though. As you say, Tommy, and you're quite right, they've got pace to burn. But Uruguay, given their full marks, I mean, just before that half-time whistle, they started to put a lot of pressure on that Canadian line, and were rather unfortunate not to have added to their scoreline of 5 points. So it's the player who came on, Santiago Silva, with the kickoff, and that is a terrible kickoff. In fact, it's going to be a penalty. The ball didn't go the required 10 yards. And
well, you shouldn't make fundamental mistakes like that, Mike. You're up against a team like Canada. You can't afford to make the mistakes. You've got to execute properly. I mean, there's no excuse for something like that.
Santiago Silva came on at just before halftime and took that chance they had at a penalty kick, looked very confident, and didn't get the distance, and now he only too happy to step forward and take the kick off, and really has put his team now in a bit of a problem area. They've got to face this scrum, see how low Canada pack. They really do spend a lot of time in training, working on their scrummaging.
They heal it well too, don't they?
Forward by Rob Card. That one safely taken, and clearance there right off the side of the boot. That will go back now for Canada throw or a scrum. What are they going to elect to do?
Well, Rob Card made a mistake there, Mike. He should have kicked for touch. I imagine he tried to kick for touch. Instead, he put it right down through the middle.
Well, Canada elect to take the throw. They have been dominant in the line-outs, but just occasionally Uruguay just seem to get their jump in absolutely right, and they do cause problems for Canada. But with the Canada put in, you would expect that would go, and you see tremendous height and a great grab there. That was Magnus Felix, the big second rower, and he's still got the ball as he tries to drag his way through. Now he releases it. Canada switching it wide, and that was Courtney Smith, and losing out that time. It was a heavy challenge, hadn't really got to control of the ball.
Oh, he got hammered just as he was about to take the ball, Mike. Could have been a disaster, but he's okay.
Yes, there's been some heavy hits out there, and both sides are spilling the ball with the ball at times. One thing, of course, in rugby union is that you really do have to treasure the ball. All about keeping possession, and you've got possession, actually creating something with the ball.
Well, Card with good distribution when the ball is heeled back to him, but the scrum was spun around that time. Canada didn't get it out cleanly, so they put it in again. They got possession, but
well, Uruguay in fact have made a few changes, and it seems that they've actually strengthened their scrummaging, Tommy. In the first half, it was Canada who were dominating, but now you saw there it was Uruguay who were actually starting to push Canada off the ball a bit.
Yeah, they're using their weight And I think the Canadians, to be successful here, Mike, they've got to keep it wide. They've got to play away from Uruguay's strength. That's not a good kick.
Not too much distance with that, but at least they did find touch this time, which they've had trouble doing throughout this game so far. Yes, I think Canada now have got to perhaps spin it wide, because they have got the beating of Uruguay in speed if they can get it wide. And now with this pack that are starting to dominate for Uruguay, if they can keep it away from those big forwards, I think that's the way for Canada to go.
Not alone that it'll slow them up if they have to start running line to line, sideline to sideline. It'll take a lot of the steam out of their ship. But here's where they're good, Mike. Look at this.
Yes, and this is something we didn't see too much of in the first half. And they're keeping possession. The man there turned, but he was still facing his own teammates, ready to release the ball. Referee has found a penalty. Canada going in behind the vertical. So another penalty being taken by Sarira. Well, he found touch. He didn't get too much distance, but he is now got his teammates into the Canadian 25.
Well, he got them inside of the line, but I thought he would have tried to kick it more for the corner, Mike, and try that coffin kick in the corner, but he just went for safety. And you can see here the reason why he went for that is he reasons that Uruguay is going to win the line out. Didn't reason right.
No, Canada winning that, and another tremendous jump by Felix. And now Canada getting possession, played back there for Bob Ross, and he finds touch. Well, Bob Ross has had a very good game, hasn't he, Tommy, so far?
Yeah, it took him a while to hit his stride, but now that he's found his kicking touch, I mean, everything, he's such deft touches driving it into over the touchline.
Not only that, Tommy, his passing, his distribution has been very good as well.
Yeah, he's a good man back there, and the Card has impressed me as well, Mike. Rob Card.
Ball loose at the back of the scrum. It looked like a forward pass from our angle, but the referee has allowed play to go on. Now Canada, and using their pace there, but running straight into the strength of the Uruguayan side. They're running straight into the pack.
Yeah, I mean, the option was to come this way. Nichols is the man who breaks across the middle, and I'm not sure why he didn't spread it wide.
Well, they've taken this quick tap. What they need to do now is really suck the Uruguay pack in and then spin it wide. But they're trying to go straight through the middle, and they've lost the ball. The ball is loose. And the referee has decided there will be a scrum, and the put-in will go with Uruguay.
Well, maybe that's what the Canadians are trying to set up, Mike. They're suckering them over towards the right-hand side of the field as Uruguay come up, which leaves you an awful lot of room left over on the left-hand side. But there's a medical emergency here. Somebody has to be tended a twisted knee or something.
Yes, I think he finished up under a couple of players in that last maul. But this is a better performance in this second half from Uruguay. They seem slower now up front, Tommy. They certainly don't have the mobility that they had, but they've now got some extra weight there. That's worrying the Canadians. But as you said, if they can spin it wide and use players with the speed of Courtney Smith or the other winger, for that matter, Carl Nichols, Uruguay could be in trouble. But they've won this scrum. And the referee there spotting a knock-on. The call.
Going to be Canadian put in, is it?
It's Canadian put in.
Rob Card, the man who makes his living as a bartender out there playing in this kind of an international. That's what's so great about rugby union, isn't it?
Oh yes, you go through some of the international teams, and if you see what they do for a living, there is players who are playing who are lawyers, and they might be packing in the second row next to a guy who's a builder's labourer. But when they're out there, they're all teammates, and same in the clubhouse afterwards. This is about a surge forward from Canada, and there was hands that time, and they belong to a Uruguay player, and so that will be a penalty for Canada. It was Panenza who had his hands in there, stopping the ball from being dragged back.
Of course, you can't put your hands in there when the ball is on the ground like that. A good call by the referee. Referees in the rugby union have such amazing eyesight, Mike. It's amazing that they catch so many of what goes on.
Yes, and they also miss a lot as well, but I think if they can sort of at least see the obvious. Now this penalty, and again Bob Ross, good distance with that clearance, and now throw for Canada inside the Uruguay 25.
Well, Ross is such an important feature from this Canadian team. When the Canadians beat the United States in the Pacific Rim tournament, not alone did he score all those penalty goals, but he also scored the winning try in the last minute to defeat the Americans. The Americans had scored one more try in the total tournament, but the Canadians got 21, the Americans 22, but the Canadians won the tournament outright.
Canada winning that throw. Now the ball spread wide. Nice runaround move. Still the ball is loose, and Canada, and that time they've knocked it on. They've given it back now to Uruguay. And a clearing kick from Ferez. And Uruguay sprinting forward that time, trying to stop the quick throw, which they managed to do.
Well, John Hutchison in there for Canada is really playing very well, the number seven. Been a nice break there, but he didn't have the support. Once he went to move the ball, Uruguay covered it up very quickly. Consultation here with the referee. Did he miss something that...
Yes, I think the touch judge has seen something that perhaps went on off the ball. And just reporting it to the referee. And the referee, the touch judge has told him that there was a punch thrown, and it was thrown there by the number eight of Uruguay, Omaichia. Captain, and or in fact I'm not sure if it was him or if the referee was just telling him, because he was the captain, why this penalty is being given. But great chance this now for Canada.
Well, that was probably the reason, Mike. He didn't seem to indicate any particular number of the player, just warning the captain. And one thing you're not allowed to punch. If anybody spots it,
Bob Ross, 3 from 7. This one just outside the 22-metre line.
Look at how delicately he puts it down.
Well, there is such a good covering of grass on this field, is that the reason these little buckets are coming on, they're bringing in some dirt to build the mound. I mean...
And you notice most of the kickers kick with the lace against their foot, as in comparison to American football, where generally they'll kick away with the lace away from their foot. These guys kick into the lace.
Now Ross, that's through the centre. He's on fire now, and Canada get the first points of the second half, and they now lead by 21-5.
Well, Bob Ross has certainly been the difference here today. I mean, those kicks, that one was measured perfectly, dropped it up high, and the Canadians have something to celebrate. Maple Leafs are enjoying this one.
Uruguay kicking off again, well taken by Canada, and there was a clash of heads there as well.
Wierzchowski really came out second best on that one. He got a tremendous knock on the head.
Yes, of course, it was he who scored the first try for Canada, and those clash of heads have left the player down, requiring some attention. He really has worked hard for Uruguay, this number six. He's still on his knees as this penalty is taken. And finishing up there, halfway inside the Canadian 25.
Oh, that's a good kick in this situation, Mike. Now you can really put a lot of pressure on the Canadians at the back.
And the good thing is it's about 11 or 12 yards out from the goal line, which means that the Canadians have got to line back the proper 10 yards. Of course, if it's too close, they can't line back after the goal line or behind the goal line. This is a good push now by Uruguay. Well, the Canadians really battling to try to stop the forward progress, but still Uruguay getting forward and surging over the line. It's very, very close. Another surge, and the referee, well, what has he found? He's found a penalty against Canada. They came in over the ball. Well, at least that gives Canada now time, Tommy, to perhaps reorganise slightly. There's the number six. That's Panenza. He's still on his knees. I think he's out on his knees, but they can't get him off.
Well, I think they've elected for the scrum rather than the penalty, hoping that they can hold the ball, keep it in the scrum, don't heel it out, and just push that Canadian line over. They seem to have the advantage here, Mike, with the weight.
Well, Panenza is packed into this scrum, and he's down on his knees. That far side, he's still on his knees. I don't think he can get up, Tommy.
Well, he's been on his knees for a long, long time. This whole sequence of play, everybody's getting down alongside him now. They're packing it in high this time. Look at this. Going to push it up from the back.
Well, I think they're trying to make sure that the Canadians can't really get a good foothold there. The referee wants the scrum repacked.
You want to see a bit of ferocity. Watch this. Watch as the heads go in together. Watch. You wouldn't want to click heads here. Watch this now when they just come to contact. Look at that. What power.
And now Uruguay. They've won the heel. And now they're trying to lock it in the back row. And just use their force. They're trying to wheel it round. Good move that time. But it's all closed down. And Canada again offside.
Look at who came out to stop the forward progress, but Ross is the man down at the bottom, number 10. See how quickly he came off his line?
Well, he spotted the danger. No self-preservation that time. And now Uruguay are just going to try to drive this one over a wedge.
Oh, this is great stuff, isn't it?
Nothing subtle, just pure brute force.
Push it on, boys, push it on.
And you can see how close they are to the line. Now they're over the line, if somebody can fall, but Canada are keeping them upright. And still the push, there's a punch thrown there as well.
Oh, the captain, maybe it was him that punched on the opposite end. He certainly punched on this end, Mike. Referee didn't see him.
Well, the referee going over to, I think, talk to the...
Courtney Smith came up with the ball. How did he manage to get a grip of it?
I'm not sure, but the touch judge has also seen something.
I think he saw that punch from Momachaya, the captain of Uruguay. He had to see it. He was standing in the right position to see it.
Who's the referee going to talk to? And what's his... In fact, it's stamping.
Oh, there's the stamp. You can see one of them. Oh, look at that. He stamps right on his belly. He puts his foot there and reels him over. Oh, he was caught flagrantly there, wasn't he?
Yes.
Look at that.
Oh, my cheer, the captain. There he is.
Oh, yeah, not the greatest sportsman in the world, considering that. And the Canadians get away with one, Mike. They punted out of there. I mean, that was... I mean, he really stomped down him. Although I think, in fairness to him, he took his foot off at the last moment. He didn't really crucify him to the turf.
Well, the throw in quickly taken in Uruguay there. Caught napping. Knock on there, though, by Canada. And now the Uruguayan put in.
That's a new version of a line-out, wasn't it? The Canadians went low and easy.
Well, they played it straight to the front, and Uruguay were already waiting and trying to get lined up, expecting the normal throw to the middle or to the back.
Well, that was a foolish move by the captain, Mike, in retrospect. I mean, it's never a good play to be dirty, but they were right down on the line there. All he had to do was keep it clean, and it looked like they were going to push the Canadians over.
Well, Canada might have an advantage in the weight of the pack, but the way that the Uruguayans are now pushing, although one would expect that might have been the starting pack from Uruguay, and they have made some changes.
Suarez is the man who gets nailed over there, the number two player.
Penalty to Uruguay, which they've taken quickly. Now this is Omaichia, the captain. Canada weren't back the required 10 paces.
Well, he needs to atone now for that fatal error he made. Error in judgment, Mike. You get the job as the captain, you're supposed to lead by example, and he certainly hasn't done it. because maybe you were right, maybe, Mike, that's who the referee was talking to earlier, too, on the last penalty when Uruguay got penalised.
Well, we're going to have another one of those flying wedges as they try to just force their way, the battering ram approach through this Canadian defence.
Calandra's the big man in the middle. He's going to do the pushing. There to go.
And it's Calandra there just turning his back.
They're locked arms and no place for the faint of heart in there now, is it?
No, it isn't. And again, this is good mauling by Uruguay as they've now got it wide. They're getting closer and closer to that line. Canada just holding them up and putting their hands in the scrum. That stops the momentum, but it gives Uruguay a penalty.
Here comes the flying wedge again.
Yes, I'm sure it's going to be that. Well, Uruguay have really been camped down in this area of the field for what, the last nearly feels like 10 minutes, Tommy. The Canada, though, are doing well. They're holding out, just.
Yeah, they're just holding out. I mean, this is a big, big onslaught.
Here they come again. Everybody wanting to get in the act this time.
Hendry's on the ground. Look at him down there. He's in a dangerous position, isn't he? Number two player.
Well, he plays hooker for Canada. He's used to being in danger areas as Uruguay get the ball out of the scrum. Now, if they can just hook it back, they've sucked a lot of the Canadians into that scrum area. They're over the line. If they can get it down, and they can. Well, they deserve that, Tommy, because they worked so hard, and in the end, it was really just brute force that got them over.
And is it Calandra, the big man?
Yes, Calandra, I think the prop who scored that. Well, he led the charge forward.
Well, it was perseverance. I mean, if you go back to where they started out on the left-hand side of the field, and look at this. I mean, the Canadians get back in good shape. They have plenty of men on the line, but here comes the push, and they're going to push it on in.
So, Calandra is the player who is credited with that try. And the handful of Uruguayan supporters who are here must have something to cheer about. And if they can convert this, this is going to make this a very interesting game. It's 21-10. With the conversion to come, that would make it up to 21-12. And we could really be in for a grandstand finish. So Guerri to take the conversion attempt. One chance to miss that, but he doesn't miss this time. And it's now Canada 21, Uruguay 12. More to come when we return. Welcome back then to Ottawa in Canada, the 1996 Pan American Rugby Series, Uruguay against Canada. And it's Canada 21, Uruguay 12. And what an exciting finale is building up in this game. Uruguay, who looked completely out of it at the end of the first half, have come back with a sterling performance and really were rewarded by that try from Calandra. So you see there some 13 minutes left.
Well, it was pure determination on their part, Mike, that pushed it over. I mean, the captain had made a terrible blunder on one side, but he was vindicated. They got the try.
They're just spilling the ball. Now Uruguay. And the ball back. Right across that time. This is Constable. Good turn there. The number 22 there, who has only made his presence felt since he has come on.
Well, the one thing the Uruguayans can't afford to get done now is they can't afford to get sucked in, Mike, and give Canada a score on the break. That's the one thing they can't afford to do.
There's a collapse that time, and the penalty goes to Uruguay.
Well, they're on a run now. You just got to wonder about the discipline. Can they hold it together? Can they just keep the pack together the way they need it? Because if the Canadians can string it out wide, Mike, could be a bad scene for the Uruguayans.
I think that's what Canada has got to do. They've been trying to beat Uruguay by going through the forwards. And I think we've already noticed that that is the strong point of this Uruguayan side.
You can't beat them with brute force. I mean, if they're going to beat them, they've got to beat them technically, and they've got to beat them by running.
Yeah, if you remember back to the first half, Tommy, it was the speed of the Canadians that really had Uruguay in a lot of trouble. We can see that their pack is very big, it's very strong, but it's not the fastest. It's reasonably mobile, but there's no way it's going to keep up with those fast backs, and if they can move the ball wide, I think Uruguay are going to be in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, it looks like that's the scenario, but of course a lot of the Canadians out there are sucking for air. I mean, trying to hold these big guys at bay is really doing a job on their energy.
Again, Uruguay trying to go through the Canadian pack, and the ball not going to come out, and again hands across from Canada.
Oh, Panizia, the big number six, is causing a riot out there in the lineouts. I mean, he's just fleecing them.
So we've now got another penalty for Uruguay, an opportunity for them to kick for touch, get a good field position. Well, they've got the field position just inside the 22-meter line.
Could we see that flying wedge coming again very soon?
It might be a little bit too far for them this time, but I think if they can get it another 5 or 10 yards forward, I think it's very much on the cards, Tommy.
I mean, a good play would be now to win the ball, kick it back into touch, and then try to get it out of the line-out and wedge it across.
Again, the referee there, Santiago Borsani from Argentina, ensuring that there is a good passage and that ball to be thrown into. And Uruguay have won this. Now, the flick up, good run in that time. And again, everybody now hungry for the ball for Uruguay. It was hooked back there by Pola.
Longo's the man who's carrying 4 or 5 of them with him now.
And the Uruguayan pack getting there in numbers. And winning the ball. And now the drop goal. And that's through. So another 3 points for Uruguay. It's 21-15, and the drop goal there from Silva. Well, he's been trying to get one over, Tommy. His place kicking left a lot to be desired, but certainly that time he got everything right.
Oh, he got it right, and he hit it so quickly. He found himself dead straight in front of the goal, and he said, why not? I missed one from the penalty. I missed one when I was kicking out. This time, maybe third time is the charm, and he got it up, and he split the uprights. Brilliant, brilliant drop goal, Mike.
A brilliant goal, quickly taken. And that makes this game now very, very interesting indeed. As Canada come back strongly. And now Canada. The line was open that time. Uruguay is going to sleep slightly.
I think Uruguay were caught celebrating a little bit there, Mike. The Canadians had a quick break, and now they have the opportunity for a score.
Yes, it's 3 points the difference. Uruguay 18, Canada 21. And just about 8 minutes left to play.
Up stepped Mr. Ross again, I'd say.
Well, I would think from here, Tommy, he could throw it over. You'd have to think that this would be a give me for 3 points.
As they say where I come from, he could kick it over in his stocking feet. He doesn't need boots at all on this occasion. Just nice and soft, put it up there between the uprights.
Well, Ross kicking better and better as this game has gone on, and now with an opportunity to open up a 6 point gap yet again for Canada. And that's what he does, makes it look so simple. Bob Ross, the 5'8". And that is now Uruguay 18, Canada 24. And Uruguay know that they've got to get a converted try. To go ahead, even a couple of penalties will only put them on level terms.
Well, the man from British Columbia has certainly done his job here tonight, Mike. The James Bay Club are going to be very happy and very proud of him. He's the difference here. Without him, Canada were in trouble.
Yes, and the player who really has surprised me is Courtney Smith. I mean, he looked so explosive in that first period of the first half, but since then, really, he's really gone missing, hasn't he?
Well, I think he's run out of gas just a little bit, Mike. We kind of alluded to it earlier. A late bloomer, but late bloomers don't last that long in these rugby games. They can be good for a half, good for 50 minutes, but the pace then begins to tell, and he hasn't really been a force at all.
Oh, the offside that time. They just held the ball back. Canada and Uruguay fell for the offside trap. So now we've got a penalty for Canada.
You can look at Courtney there, Mike. He just looks like he's just sucking a little air. See him in the corner of a picture there? He's just saying, yeah, just give me another 5 minutes, Lord.
Well, this is another penalty for Canada. It's right in front. And Bob Ross. So takes the opportunity to get some liquid refreshment. 5 from 9 so far today. This is his 10th kick.
Oh, 6 for 10, he'd be over 500. Some of them were very difficult. I mean, there were a couple, one down on the touchline, just it would have taken a brilliant kick to get it in. You either make those or you don't, Mike, and these ones are so simple.
Well, this one is a very good position, but it is a long way out. So it's just really a case of the right distance and making sure he's got enough height. One he took earlier went just under the crossbar, and it wasn't a much different position to what this one is.
This one's just a little straight.
Oh, and he's hooked it. Well, this time he's got the height, he got the distance, but he got the direction all wrong. And no wonder he can shake his head.
Well, that was the problem. It was a little bit straight. You're much better if you had a little bit of an angle to the side. He probably could have made that had it be angled to the side. In particular, with a right-footed kicker like that, he angled him over a little bit to the left. But when you got to hit it straight on, you know, you can't afford any hook at all, and he hooked it big time.
Yes, of course, the style of rugby kickers has changed considerably in the last 10 years. They used to be the straight up and down, the hit it with the toe, but now they've all sort of really come into the way that the footballers in soccer really kick it. They try it with like the inside of the foot, and they try to curve it, etc.
Well, a man called Peter Gogolak brought that into vogue with the Buffalo Bills many years ago. They used to call him a sidewinder or a soccer kicker, and so many now of the rugby players have gone to doing the same thing. I mean, they really hit it with the side of their foot, and you can see Calandra, the man who scored one of the try for Uruguay, going off there.
Yes, and he'll be a sorely missed player in these remaining few moments of, that are left of this game. He was so inspirational, but he was working so hard. Not surprising, though, that he's gone off, because he has put in so much of an effort in this game. And of course, for both these teams, it's just their first match of three games that they will play in the 1996 Pan American Rugby Series. Of course, we'll be bringing all the games here on ESPN. It's so important in these very small tournaments of just four teams that you do get off to a winning start.
Oh, certainly, if we get as much entertainment out of the rest of the games as we've gotten out of the first two, Mike, this should be a good tournament.
Oh, certainly Uruguay have got to be given full marks for effort. They have refused to throw in the towel. They have worked hard for parts of the first half. It looked like they were going to be overrun, but they have dug deep, and they are still going, and ball knocked forward that time. Some of the Uruguayan players questioning the referee. Was the ball knocked forward because the Canadian player who actually forced the release was in an offside position? And the touch judge on that far side has seen something again. There's one Machado, who's another one of the changes who's come on. In fact, he's come on to replace Calandra, who's gone off.
Another stomping case, I believe. The referee indicating that somebody stomped. He's going to have a chat with somebody again, and it's in the blue side.
And the penalty goes against Uruguay.
Well, that could be costly.
Yes, it could be, but Ross this time is deciding to kick for touch. And fouls to find it, does he? No. The touch judge on that far side says the ball actually went out. It wasn't the best of kicks, though, from Well, Ross, let's see if we can see what happened with that stamp in charge.
Well, I don't see any sign of it there. It must be out of our picture.
It's always difficult for officials, Tommy, because when the ball's on the ground, everybody's going for it, and you've really got to be able to try to work out if a player is going for the ball or trying to injure an opponent.
Well, that's the big decision to be made. I mean, there's sometimes you're trying to put your foot in to try to gain some little foothold for yourself, and you mistakenly step on somebody who's on the ground. So the referee's got to take that into consideration, or whoever makes the call.
So it is a throw on that far side then for Canada. High one, and Uruguay have won it this time. And Canada again coming over the ball. They have been guilty of that quite a number of times throughout, Tommy.
Yeah, well, that's been a very constant signal from the referee. And mind you, while he has his hand up in the air, he decides, maybe I better check time. It's starting to run out here.
Well, Uruguay want to get the ball down to the other end as quickly as possible. They trail here by 6 points. Of course, a converted try could give them seven. They really didn't get too much distance with that clearance.
Well, there's a couple of very interesting games coming up, isn't there? It's going to be very interesting when Uruguay plays Argentina. Battle of South America. That just might be a battle too, Mike.
Yes, and then you've got the Battle of North America as well, haven't you? You've got the USA up against Canada.
That's a repeat of the Pacific Rim final tournament. So there's a lot of good rugby to be played in this tournament.
There's a lot of bragging rights that are up for grabs. This game is far from finished at this stage as Uruguay still throwing themselves forward. I mean, what a feather in their cap it would be if they could defeat this Canadian side. We talked earlier about the top rung of rugby, which would have to be England, Wales, Scotland and France from Europe, and then you look at New Zealand, Australia from the Pacific, and perhaps now South Africa as well. It will certainly South Africa, and then perhaps Fiji. But after that, then you come to that second tier, which Argentina were really always the best team, but certainly Canada now very much up there, Tommy, very much into calculation.
I refuse to comment. You left out a team in Europe. Purposely, I presume, the men in green, white and gold, but Canada certainly have to enter into the equation now once you get outside of that Five Nations tournament. And who knows what's going to happen to that now with all this problem over money for television rights and everything else. Maybe the English are not going to be playing in it. Maybe it's going to be a four-term team.
Here come Canada. Can they get it down? They're still forcing it forward. They've got it on the floor. Now they can knock it back. Now they can use their speed if they can get it wide. And Courtney Smith was waiting. Referee has found a penalty. And the penalty goes to Canada. And the first aid again being called on.
Well, this one should be more to Bob Ross's liking, Mike. Little bit of an angle over here on the left hand side, so he'd be kicking right footed into the goal. Oh, I didn't realize it was as deep over as it is. I thought it was a little more towards the center, but it's got a fairly tough angle on it.
Well, it's been a battling performance from Uruguay, and some of their players are showing the scars. As the final whistle goes, there won't be time for that final penalty, and it is a victory for Canada over Uruguay. But it's a hard-fought victory, Tommy.
Yeah, it was a good performance by Uruguay. Really good performance by the Canadians. Bob Ross was the difference, Mike.
Well, we will continue our coverage of the 1996 Pan American Rugby Series when it moves on to Hamilton in Ontario. There, the USA will take on Canada. Uruguay will take on Argentina. Here, though, it was Uruguay who finished behind Canada, the host, 24-18. But what a battle both these sides put up. For Tommy Smith, I'm Mike Hill, saying thank you for joining us for International Rugby here on ESPN. Join us when Canada battle America and Uruguay take on Argentina right here on ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports.